Amashkate. Lil’wat Ulskan, Statliamskan, Inches, Rushes. Good day. My name is Yvonne Wallace and I am from the Lil’wat Nation. I am the playwright and will be reading this rough draft play, Rezonance. Rezonance has had three names so far since August 20th. And rough draft means that it isn't even to draft one phase. So we have this in an action format, which turns into narrative. I want to say a special thank you for the financial support from First Peoples Culture Council, to Arts Whistler for helping me with the delivery of this into your homes, and a special thank you to David Geary, who is my dramaturg. This is our second time working together, and he's been just monumental in creating the shape of the story and the world of that Mixy is living in. Mixy is the main character, and she has been invited to a planning of a land-based pedagogy, which is just a fancy word for teaching style and delivery. In this play, you're going to hear a lot of $10 words, and that's just my exercise as an artist to elevate my own understanding of the English language. I am supportive of Uhlamuksh and the development and growth within our nation. I also believe, to find some balance, that we have to understand both worlds to consider this crazy climate that we're living in. And having said that, this play was recorded on April 27th, and we are at the end of June now, 2 months later. Canada is unearthing some horrific traumas to the Indigenous experience. And I just hope that you can stay at the end of the YouTube delivery and click onto the Zoom link and follow us in the conversation. Having looked back at the delivery of this play, I know that I'm on a good path. If you've had an opportunity to see my other plays, you would know about me that I'm going to go through several drafts for Utsan, which was delivered at Arts Whistler in 2019. It had between 9 and 12 drafts. So this is pre-draft. This is not even to draft form yet. So we have a lot of action in the first act, and then we move into narrative. And I do have some more time with David Geary, and we are going to be collecting action items and moving it into narrative. And I have been in discussions with other theaters that will help me along in the process. So I will collect six actors and sit back and be the playwright, which is a luxurious process. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for your generosity, and thank you for holding hope in the Indigenous way. I wish you a good, safe day. Kukshtim Kalap. Hi, I'm Mixy. I've combined my personal notes to form this reflection. My mind, body, and spirit have been challenged in the most aggressive way this year. Having said that, for me to download, process, and honestly reflect, I thought I'd make these entries as a play synopsis. I hope you can be flexible with me. I wanted to distance myself from the actual experience so that I didn't become too attached to the emotional aspects of my experience. Furthermore, I wanted to make this nightmare for me into as much fun and a creative process and honest expression. I come from a place of being mindful that it's my responsibility to keep my integrity intact and not to compromise that. I have a sacred responsibility. A sacred responsibility to honor myself, my parents, and all of my ancestors. I've been invited to participate in an Indigenous pedagogy retreat with Brown University. The reason that I was invited was because of my previous experience of learning my first language. The creator of the Indigenous retreat had found a pocket of money for me to be involved. I identified myself as an Indigenous woman who is gaining momentum with fluency. So, of course, I'm thrilled to be invited to the table. Who wouldn't be, right? I have been invited to several meetings prior to the world shifting as we knew it, as I knew it, as we all knew it, the world of Zoom and its pitfalls. The never-ending, we can't hear you, you're on mute. I noticed that there was a tendency to put me on the spot, my nice little mixed race spot. I began working tirelessly to make sure that I was well educated on every aspect of planning. If we discussed Kovic, Archibald, Wilson, or Culhane, I would read every article. So when I was questioned, I was in a good position to answer. Politics at the virtual table were alive and thriving. You know, residential school residue. I grew up on reserve, looking out, and everyone that I saw was brown. So my vision of the world was brown. I simply was brown, like everyone else. However, everyone who was looking at me saw a little white girl. Long story short, my friends call me Mixy. There is a new song that's been, that's the story unfolds. It goes something like this. Half-breed, double standard, half-breed, double standard. And I have it on repeat in my brain because, you see, there are a different set of rules for me. On January 10th, the strategist calls an online meeting to introduce themselves to the team. Eddie, the elder, is not present. The strategists wanted to know if there is anything that the land-based planning group would like to address before day one, January 17th. Anxious, the creator is not at the first meeting. The meeting goes on as scheduled and is somewhat cryptic, and no one is sure how to address the real complexities. The strategist asks about cultural protocol, and Evangeline skips the answer, but says, are we to read all of the material assigned? This is the first indication of some disconnect in educational experiences and expectations. I recognize that we are working in a deficit model. The whole model of lower expectations. We make education accessible. We create our own glass ceiling, or in my case, close the hatch on the pit house and smoke me out so that I don't want to be here. This is a university. Of course, we read all of the assignments. The evening of the 16th, I learned that I have been selected first to present first about a topic I know nothing about. And my performance is being evaluated by members of the team. I begin reading all the material. In preparation for the hyper-focus I anticipate. Just to catch you up. History has shown in the last three meetings, it's trendy to ask questions that feel directed at me. I know this because This is a question for Mixy. What do you mean by dominant discourse? Are you saying we are like that, or is the rest of the university exercising the dominant discourse model? Both. The intent to either put me on the spot or find my weakness, the questions and spot putting are not fun. What is fun for me is the aha moments, insights, new vocabulary, you know, to share and open freely. Instead, I feel stifled, shut down, and familiar to these tactics. Elder Eddie and his girlfriend, they throw at me because I recognize the same mannerisms in my siblings who all went to Indian residential school. And I'm apprehensive to point out because there is no current climate to my oppression. I mean, look at me. I look like the oppressor and identify as the oppressed. Residential school residue. Who else thinks about these things? Betrayal, paradox, paradigms. The web of interconnected healing. What kind of leader are we set up to be after all is said and done? I digress. The day begins with a lot of anxiety for me. The strategist frantically managing the online platform. The elder starts to make small talk on the chat group. The strategist opens the leadership meeting with questions of, what kind of leader are you? I think to myself, I'm a lot like my mother. I like everyone to feel included. Okay, strong opening. We talk about dominant discourse and Jodi Wilson-Raybould's introductory paragraph in her book. The part where she explains matriarchal lineage and operates her truth-telling as a way of honoring her ancestry. At least that was the intention of the strategist. There was no way to know what was about to transpire. We have a guest, and he spoke about his master's thesis of organizing a warriors club and shows an uplifting video. Eddie interrupts. Yeah, I have a question. Who do you think you are, taking those young men into the forest and guiding them? Who are you? I see right away there's a miscommunication. Eddie thought the guest was a non-Indigenous person delivering Indigenous pedagogy. Every great play has a miscommunication to add comedy relief, but things escalated really fast. I saw the racism, expressed discomfort, and the strategist intervened. Later, I deliver the education trauma-informed practice, Schmidt, Parent, and Vassello, all at the same time. I
get it. He was playing tit for tat, a well-known game on the playground. The rest of the members are speechless, and then Eddie's girlfriend directs a question at me. I have a question. Do you think trauma shouldn't be talked about? I mean, it's a fact. You know, I'm a residential school survivor, and it took me years to talk about my experience. Just as anticipated. And I'm relieved that I overprepared and was able to answer the question, to tie together the deficit lens. I believe that learning about yourself on the land can foster healing. The trauma is always with you. The learner is a part of the learning and inseparable from the process. So part of the learning is to find good ways to live with the trauma, leave it in the land. That's the exology and methodology I'm speaking about. I don't think you answered my question, but that's okay. Thank you, Mixy, for the presentation. Can we convene in, say, 2 weeks? Can I do the open closing prayer? Thank you, Creator, for all that you provided to us. I come to you in humility. I don't want to be the smartest Indian in the room. All I ask for is open and honest path to healing. Please give the strength to all the members to do the same over the next 2 weeks. All my relations. The day started with some division. Evangeline requested a sharing circle, but not before monopolizing the prayer process and inviting a revealed elder to the circle, and then having everyone wait for 50 minutes for Eddie the elder to join the Zoom meeting. The sharing circle wasn't assigned a moderator because in the past it's always been that everyone shares at length and diverts from the topic. There was no way for the strategist to know what was about to unfold. It started off slow. This mic guy says, you know, I'm okay with uncomfortable. Sometimes things get
uncomfortable. And I'm okay with silence. We don't really need to talk about the last meeting. That's just my opinion. This, coming from a guy who has never had to think about dominant discourse, because he embodies dominant discourse. He speaks indirectly to me, basically. It was uncalled for me to say anything because I was uncomfortable. And I'm the fourth to speak because we like to do things in fours. And I'm going to speak honestly, just like Jody Wilson-Raybould, and tell my truth. Jody Wilson-Raybould has spent her entire life driving and guiding the Canadian public into policy change from an Indigenous perspective. In 2018, she was the first Indigenous Justice Minister to be elected into cabinet. For those of you who don't know Jody before this, the SNC scandal, where a multi-billion dollar corporation was trying to push their limitations and boundaries with regards to offshore development. Jody was centered in her beliefs and values based on the big house. She had come from a long line of matriarchs, and she couldn't operate any other way. The only way that she could do leadership was with integrity, strength of character, and honoring those that came before, while honoring those that will come after. I get ready. I take a deep breath. I begin to explain my whole life being positioned in challenging the weight of the mixed race lens. I felt attacked passively, aggressively by the chat on the online platform, brought on by this life-threatening global pandemic to which Evangeline begins taking notes. I feel disrespected and triggered. Evangeline, why are you taking notes during a sharing circle? Oops. Maybe too far. But I didn't ask for this trauma of the sharing circle that the elders requested. And what was the point of a sharing circle if you can't speak your truth? I throw all of my thoughts about politics of colorism inside Indigenous community. Power positioning of discrimination toward our guest. The misuse of prayer in a culture that reveres elders. My discomfort with a stranger coming into the circle to do the prayer when I already felt personally attacked. And then, I will not take the role of the martyr, the scapegoat. I have always given my best when members of this committee have not always given their best effort. I'm sorry, Mixy, you're on mute. I think it's time that we take a break. Feeling silenced, like a triggered girl, I was ignored, muted. Everyone in the circle witnessed the backlash toward me over live chat. So the rest spoke in general terms, and honesty is muted. And then, I take the rest of the day for self-care. The planning of the retreat hasn't even begun. My afternoon, for the first time in 25 years, I decided today was the day to skip the afternoon session. I went to the lake. I spoke to the water. The whole white passing, light-skinned privilege they think I have. I wish I didn't say anything. I created a bigger white target, but then again, if I feel uncomfortable, I should, in theory, express that. After all, my intention is to assert that everyone is equal, right? Emotion, lack of sleep, lack of cohesion, othering, all feel very overwhelming. How do I go back? How can I have done things differently? How did I participate in letting the institution slide in decorum? Not everyone is going to have the same values. It doesn't make me any better or worse. I'm beat up. I have no energy to focus on the reading material. I just moved my teenager and home from the city to country. I was pushed out of my language teaching job by politics of mixed heritage versus full heritage. The life of the single mother. I can do it all. But I wish I had help. In the morning, Eddie is called on to pray. Doesn't anyone else find this problematic? Wannabe elder, who always carries an eagle feather as a bookmark. Only 55, promoted himself early. He has tattoos across his knuckles saying, thug life. He's changed the T into a totem pole, and so it says, hug life. Giving thanks is often practiced in Indigenous pathways, and how is anyone ever going to get comfortable with prayer if they don't have a chance to practice? The benefit for everyone taking a turn is that everyone is equal in the practice. Let it go, Mixy. You're already so easy targeted. Meanwhile, the strategist opens the day with three styles of leadership: the autocratic, the democratic, the laissez-faire, and the awareness of flexibility to use different styles based on situation. Okay. I know that I prefer democratic, and I make a mental note. Guest two is brought in by the strategist and speaks about dominant discourse, creating community inside of a non-nurturing work environment, her relationship to her elder, which reminds me of a quote about Indigenous ways of knowing and being. And then the question about lateral violence arises. And I recoil. I am so glad the attention is not on me. Until I learned that there's going to be a 5:30 Zoom meeting with the Creator tomorrow. Doom sets in. I have a hunch it will be about my share and the elders. They begin to celebrate. Later in the afternoon, Eddie and Evangeline present their idea for the retreat. They begin by introducing themselves as the smartest Indian. And I feel the passive-aggressive dig. Does anyone else recognize? I wonder. Meaning, if you're the smartest Indian in the room, you shouldn't be there. The presentation begins. They share past stories again, and the articles weren't being discussed. Guest three enters the Zoom meeting at the end of the discussion, heard the stories, and congratulated the elders for their insight. I wish you really knew the truth. Guest three is somewhat legendary because he introduced the idea of grafting in an article I read last month. He held space. He had a calming voice and used words like tokenized, neoliberalism, ontology, neuro-decolonizing, Indigenous lens, stratifying, and my favorite, concurrent realities. He discussed Dion's Perfect Stranger, the impact of colonial projection of Indigenous identity, and lessons in ceremonial pain versus traumatic pain. I was in that moment happy to be a part of the circle. Even if I had to deal with the impending scapegoating that was about to be onset by the Creator tomorrow. My ceremonial pain. I called the strategist to reassure her and thank them for rallying the troops and bringing in great speakers. Also, to touch base and have a frank conversation about perspectives and assert leadership ideas and disclose some real honest life lessons. I was really wanting to know if the 5:30 meeting was about me. It was. But how is the strategist to know? Before the meeting, we discussed with warm mannerism, identity, positionality, and the positive contribution to Indigenous allyship. Can you speak to positionality? It was at this moment I realized that I had been taking for granted that this language is my comfort language. And not everyone has the same skill set. So that must have something to do with their aversion to the reading. I'm humbled by my revelation. I'm in awe at the D skill. There is a break, and everyone except for the guest is to reconvene at 5:30 to meet with the Creator. Impending doom sets in. The strategist believes that everyone is missing the Creator and is in need of guidance. What the strategist is about to learn is that the elder's girlfriend is about to start a sharing circle to rebuttal the first sharing circle. She is noticeably upset, if not more upset than I was the day before. She feels like I had discriminated against her and made her feel like a stupid Indian. Just like in the Indian residential school days, she said. And that I was disrespectful. Mike, the affluent, hand-picked male being groomed to support the creator one day, he chimes in with, "Yeah, I hear you. I acknowledge your pain. I, too, felt shocked at the disrespect by Mixy." I wish that somebody did that for me when I was sharing.
Yeah. I wasn't there, but I heard about it, and something must be done about Mixy's disrespect.
All while diverting from the fact that Eddie was publicly shaming guest one and started the downward toxic spiral in the first place. I think, is this what it feels like to be Jody Wilson-Raybould? Speaking her truth, and then finding myself here in a hearing just like this one, with everyone watching. The witch hunt was going as planned. I take a deep breath. Channel my best Jody. Grab my tobacco, hold it in my left hand, and finish what I started. I tell my truth with clarity, less emotion, and more empathy. I even took a moment to apologize to Evangeline, practicing that whole rise above it thing that my grandmother spoke about. The strategist, she spoke up in support of me. I learned at that moment I had an ally, and that one day I would do the same for her when necessary. I was no longer the martyr because others were willing to display truth regardless of fear and persecution from the circle. The strategists shared their feelings and experiences from the last few meetings. Then the creators spoke about their intention for the program, messaging that everyone needs to get to work and pull up their big girl panties, which was problematic because we all know that Eddie doesn't wear panties. I take a big sigh of relief and give thanks to my deceased grandmother. Her strength of conviction and empathy and knowledge. I can hear her like it was yesterday. You see, you put the mistake in first, so you don't have to worry about being perfect. So this part of the play is still in development, and so I thought I would just run through the action. Everyone arrives at the retreat. Tensions are still high, and everyone is clearly ready to be on the land. The first evening, there's pandemonium. The prayers start, and Mixy can't take it. Evangeline elbowed her for the smudge bowl, and it was game on. Long story short, Mixy walked 32 miles back to civilization. She was attacked by a bear, and she was missing for 5 days. A report was filed, and Brown's University was terrified that Mixy was going to press charges after she was found barely alive. Mixy used this to her advantage, and she wanted the university to give her the lead role in next year's land-based pedagogy retreat. The final day of meeting online for presentations. There is no opening prayer, and I'm relieved. The first group speak about financial policies changing, funding programs that still exist, and nihilism and systemic problems for racialized educators and their students. The strategist speaks to the strengths of a local identifying non-Indigenous ally and the reading content, the strength in education, and like poetic justice, I was perfectly in cue to share the last word. The lesson. You don't always have to share the last word if people are not listening to you. But I wanted to share my last stimulating thought because finally, we're talking about moving forward and not toxic politics. There are no prayers, just everyone bidding adieu. The Zoom screen goes black. I go home and I lie in bed. I don't even have the energy to cry. Contemplating quitting the program because it would feel less violent and triggering for me in a non-Indigenous institution. At very least, I can focus on what I was supposed to learn instead of what I already know. And having to reenact personal trauma. On the other hand, people who can learn from my area of focus, they're in the Indigenous community. My focus is on dismantling the elder role in its current colonized state of old person and defining a more holistic agenda for the elder role in education. I can't believe that happened. Why did I say anything to begin with? The whole thing was an exhibition of interconnectedness of the Indian residential school and the residue of the trauma in Indigenous community. It was pushback. I was pushed back against playground politicking, bullying learned in the Indian residential school playgrounds. I want to be right. I can't be right all the time. You're human too. Be kind to yourself. You are only human. Human in a world of mixed messages. You're going to make that camp the way you want it to be. No ambush, fucking sharing circles. If there are more than four people, it's called an ambush. No one is ever going to give impromptu sharing circles in my space. Passive-aggressive, aggressive-aggressive. Hell no. I'm not a therapist.
I'm a straight and schicksal.
I just woke up. That's the first time in my daughter's life that I spent the whole day in bed. Either the ancestors were holding me or depression was setting in. You're right. I do sound like you. Thank you for joining us for the show. We will be having a talk back in live. So if you just go down to the chat, you can ask any question and I will be answering live. Thank you for joining.